continue on a little bit further. You're getting your Bible, or while you're looking up 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we're going to go to the very end of chapter 11 and go right into chapter 12. And while we're doing that, I wanted to mention to you several things. Number one, we are in the last stages of getting our building here in the Dallas area fixed up and ready to go. We're not having church service there yet, hence why we're still here and broadcasting from our media house. Now, as soon as we get back off this trip, and you say, what trip are you talking about? Well, we're going to Pennsylvania. As soon as we finish this broadcast today, we will be getting in the Yukon and taking off across the country and going to Mars, Pennsylvania. That's just a little ways north of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And we will be up there for a three-day DHT, which starts next Thursday. It'll be Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And then we will be heading back this way. As soon as we get back into the Dallas area, we'll have about a week, and then we will go right into our first three-day seminar, which will be a new man seminar, to be held at our Dallas offices. And that'll be the first time we actually use those offices for broadcasting, for teaching, for a seminar. So we're really looking forward to it. We've been working on this thing, and I signed the lease on this building back on March 9th of this year, and it has taken this long just to get in the thing, get the internet set up, and all that kind of stuff. We're still working on some of the internet capabilities. So a lot of things happening. So we want to make sure as soon as we're in the building, as soon as we get back and the building is ready to go, then we will put the address up on the website and let you know where it's at. And we would invite you to come out to it for both the seminar and for Sunday morning services. So we're excited about this. It's been a long time coming, but we do believe that this is the right time for it. And so we would start inviting all of you that want to come and visit us in the Dallas offices to let us know you're coming. We can help you find hotel rooms and that kind of stuff. And there is a hotel it's within a 3-minute walking distance from our building. So it's going to be great. And we've got there's a line of hotels there. So it's going to be very convenient for us all to get together, fellowship, spend some time. So now there is, we're even getting testimonies back from the conference. I wanted to share that with you a little bit. We had actually many other testimonies are coming in. Activations with people starting to step out in areas other than just healing, but stepping out, ministering to people, and seeing results, which is always excellent, and all the other gifts as well as healing. So we're going to talk about some of that today and how to function some of those things. And even the last night of the conference, we actually did a mass prayer, just a single mass prayer for everyone there. And there was a man there that was deaf and could not hear, which I guess that's what deaf means, so being a little redundant there. But he came to me after the service, and he came up and started talking to me and said that while I was praying the mass prayer at the end, that his ears popped open and he could hear. So we're getting that, all the details on that, and other testimonies throughout the week. But it was a great time of coming together. Now, we are looking at doing a three-day seminar at the building each month. We have one in July here that we'll be doing a new man. And then I think August we're doing one that is going to be a DHT, if I'm not mistaken. But we're also looking in the near future, in the other months, that if we do a three-day, we'll be doing a single topic each day. In other words, we'll be talking about spiritual gifts, or we'll be talking about tongues and how they operate and the functions of tongues, diversities of tongues. And so there's a lot of things that we will be discussing on these seminars. Now, we are also finalizing, I believe we just finalized our DHT, or actually it's a new man that we're going to be conducting out in Bakersfield, California. We are finalizing a DHT in Las Vegas, Nevada. And then we also have, looks like we're going to be going to Australia. And that looks like it'll be November 12 to December 3 is what we're trying to put together. It's not all written down. If you keep watching our schedule page, you'll see all this. So it'll all be on there. But we are looking forward to it. We're really excited about all that is taking place. So hopefully by now you found 1 Corinthians chapter 11. So let's read this. Now, 1 Corinthians 11 is talking about, it's the Apostle Paul writing to the Corinthians, and he is telling them that when they come together for the Lord's Supper, how to conduct themselves and how to conduct a Lord's Supper. So at the very end here, in verse 33, he says, "Wherefore, my brethren, together to eat, tarry one for another," wait for each other. "And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, So obviously this is not about just coming together to eat. This is a particular type of meal, as we've seen in the Healing and the Atonement sessions. He says that you come not together unto condemnation, and the rest will I set in order when I come. So in other words, I've already given you the basic outlines. I gave you what you needed, Paul said, and the rest that needs to be set in order, I will do that when I get there. And so he's given details. Now, that's in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Now, if you just keep on going, and you have to remember, 1 Corinthians, whenever Paul wrote Corinthians, he did not break it up into chapter and verse. That was what man did, so that it's easier to find certain verses and sentences. So, in chapter 12, Paul is continuing on along the same lines, not necessarily the Lord's Supper, but he's talking about meeting together. And so he says in verse 1, now concerning spiritual, and the word gifts is not in the original Greek, but we know it is talking about spiritual gifts because later on he mentions this thing. So we would say concerning spirituals or concerning spiritual activities or spiritual manifestations is a way of saying it. He says, now concerning spiritual gifts, spiritual manifestations, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. So he says, don't be ignorant on this. No. And if he tells us he doesn't want us to be ignorant, then obviously it is God's will for us to know about the gifts. And it's not enough for us to know from just a historical perspective. It is for us to know how to operate in the gifts. So we're going to talk about these. Now, if you've been through a lot of the New Man or in the DHT, you know that when we have taught about gifts, the emphasis has not been on the gifts. That's where the church has made a mistake, and we have emphasized the gift. And then whenever somebody operates in a gift, all of a sudden, we make a big deal out of them. And we have to realize if you're going to make a big deal out of something, it should be a big deal out of the fruit, not the gifts. Gifts are just given, but fruit is grown. Fruit shows maturity. So, now, he says, I would not have you ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away unto these dumb idols, even as you were led. Now, being led there was twofold. Number one, people led the Gentiles into following after these dumb idols, as Paul would call them. But there was also, within the very fallen nature, they were led to follow after idols. And so it's a twofold meaning there. In verse 3, he says, wherefore, I give you to understand. In other words, I want you to understand this. Remember, I just told you I don't want you to be ignorant. So I'm going to explain some things so you will understand. And he says that no man speaking by the Spirit of God will ever call Jesus accursed. So he said if anybody says that, and believe it or not, there have been many in churches throughout history that had actually said some things about Jesus that were very, just wrong, and it wasn't by the Holy Spirit. So remember, if someone says something about the Father, the Son, the Holy Ghost, or any of the aspect of the Bible, it has to be in conjunction with what the Bible has already revealed. It cannot be a new, quote-unquote, revelation. It needs to go in line with what has already been revealed before through Scripture. Now, that when I say that, I don't mean that it has to have happened before. What I mean is it cannot violate the principles of Scripture. That's what I'm talking about. Now, he says, and in the last half of verse 3, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost. So in other words, he's not saying that somebody can't just walk up and say Jesus is Lord. He's saying you cannot make Jesus your Lord and mean it in your heart and get born again except by the unction of the Holy Spirit. And what I mean by that is that the Holy Spirit works with you. He woos you. He convicts. He brings you to Christ. And he woos you to Christ himself. And that it is by the help of the Holy Spirit that you actually are led into knowing Jesus as your Lord. Now, look at verse 4. He says, now there are diversities of gifts. Now the word diversities here means a distinction or a variation, is another way to say it, or a difference, a variety. So when he says that there are diversities, he's saying there are a variety of gifts. There's a wide range of varieties. Now, the amazing thing here is that there are 9 gifts listed in this section, and then later in Galatians, which Paul also wrote, he talked about the 9 fruit. And you can actually pair these together in a lot of ways. Now, and usually people that are functioning well in a fruit will also function well in a gift that corresponds with that fruit. We'll talk about that at a later date. Don't have time to get into it today. But he says that there are diversities or varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. So, and that's what we have to remember. The variety of gifts come from the same Spirit. So now, this is not something in and of yourself. This is the Holy Spirit abiding in you that works these gifts out through your life. And there's a variety of gifts. We're going to look at them. And he says, and there are differences of administrations. Now, where it says differences, it's the same word for diversities. Same word. And so, King James translators use different words to break up the monotony. But actually, he said the exact same thing both times. Now, he said there are differences. There is a variety of administrations. And even the word administrations is where we get the word deacon from, which means to serve or service. And so there are differences of the way that things are served, difference in the way that gifts are administered, is another way to say it. And so now he says, but the same Lord. And verse 6 says, and there are diversities of operations. Again, the word diversities there is the same word as the other two before. It means a variety. So there are a variety of operations. Now, and I'm trying to get these because as we look at these individual gifts, you'll see how you can start functioning in them. But when he says that there is a variety of operations, it really means a variety of effects or of working. In other words, the same gift doesn't always work the same way in different people. Some people get a word of knowledge, for instance, and I'm jumping ahead of myself a little bit here, but when we talk about the gifts, one of the gifts is called the word of knowledge. And the word of knowledge is a knowing of a fact, something that has taken place, something that is a fact. And when it talks about this word of knowledge, some people can get it as a word. In other words, it's like they hear it almost. It's like a thought. They have a thought about something that is a fact, a knowing that they have no human way of knowing. Now, this isn't guesswork. It's not the gift of suspicion. It is knowing something that is a fact right then. And they might get it as a word or as a thought. Other people will get it as almost a vision, like a picture. And they will picture this thing, and it will be a fact, and then they just say what they saw. Now, William Branham operated that way with the word of knowledge. And so this would be a variation or differences or varieties of operations of how it actually works. And what we have to make sure is that we don't get into Christian idolatry by idolizing a certain way something works. Now, what we have to remember is that every one of these gifts are operated by the Spirit of God. They are all manifestations of the same Spirit, the Spirit of the living God. Now, as humans, we have a part and a role to play in the operation of these gifts. We have to, number one, and you know, above everything else, there are two primary things that we have to remember if we're going to deal in gifts. Now, I'm not saying that without this, gifts won't work. I'm just saying you don't want to work gifts without this. And you already have an idea of what I'm talking about. Number one is love. And we're going to talk about that toward the end of the broadcast. We will get there. So you want to operate the gifts in love for the people that you're operating with, not just as a show or as something that goes on in your life that, well, I can do this, and because I can do it, I'm going to go ahead and do it. We definitely don't want ever to be operating in a gift for the sake of monetary benefit, which very honestly has been the majority in the cases throughout church history, especially in the last, I'd say, 50 to 60 years. A lot of it has played up. Someone has a gift, and they figure out a way to make money off of that gift. So you never want to do that either. Now, you want to make sure that the reason you are ministering a gift is for love. You love the people. You love God. The second important thing, or second key that you have to remember about operating in gifts, is that without faith, it is impossible to please God. So if we're going to operate in the gifts, two things must be present, I would say, as a foundation and even as a precursor to operating in gifts. Number one is love for God and for your fellow man. And number two is faith towards God. So that means if whatever is not of faith is sin, the scripture said, then you're going to have to operate the gifts in faith. Now that means stepping out. And faith, and I'm going to say something, almost sounds like a contradiction here, but if you'll hear the idea, you'll see it's not. For faith to truly be present, then there has to be the real possibility of failure. If it's just something that would happen anyway, then there's really, it doesn't require but that is exactly the way it works. Is that, in other words, from a human standpoint, there has to be that one part that says, if this doesn't work, it's going to fail, and it's not going to work. It's that simple. On the other hand, if you're operating in faith, there, even though you may even have a thought that says it may not work, or what if it doesn't work, but if you're operating in faith, there will be no possibility of failure. Because faith, and quoting the Bible, quoting Wigglesworth, the Bible and Wigglesworth both said in different words, but both said the same thing when they said that faith always obtains its objective. Faith always obtains its objective. Now, I just opened a can of worms there, and I'll probably get emails and texts and everything else for that, but it's a fact, because people say, well, I was in faith, and this, I prayed for this person, and they didn't get healed. And I know I was in faith, so, you know, maybe it's this, maybe that. Nope. Faith works. Simple as that. If you're in faith, it works. How do you know if you're in faith? It worked. If it didn't work, you weren't in faith. End of story. People say, well, no, I know I was in faith, and that's not true. No, okay. The Bible says, which is God speaking. So if God says faith works, and you say you were in faith but it didn't work, I've got to side with God. Regardless of what you say, I have to side with God. Faith works. When you're in faith, it works. Simple as that. If it didn't work, you weren't in faith. End of story. I know that's maybe a bitter pill to swallow, as they say, but it is a fact. God is true. His word is true. When you stand on His word, you stand on His promises, and you stand in faith, it works. That's it. Now, so two things, faith and love. Love for God, love for your fellow man. Now, as I said, and I'm kind of recapping, if you're going to be operating in faith, for it to be truly faith, there has to be the possibility of failure. But, on the other hand, if you're truly in faith, there is no possibility of failure. Simple as that. Now, I know that's looking from the natural and the divine aspect of it. But now let's look on here. He says in verse, where are we at? Verse 4. Yeah, might as well read 4. Now there are diversities of gifts, the same Spirit, and there are differences of ministrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, operatings. But it is the same God which worketh all in all. In other words, these gifts, that's God. That's what you have to realize. See, again, we get back to this new creation. The new creation is God Himself dwelling in humans. And whenever He dwells in humans, then He works through humans. And the things that He does is God doing it. So that's why, as we look at these gifts, you're going to find that these gifts cover every aspect of human existence. Any problem you could ever have, any problem, can be solved or fixed by operating in one of these gifts. Now, I just want to take a second here, and I want to thank Dr. Summerall, even though he has gone on to be with the Lord. I want to thank him for the time that I spent with him, because he, by far, was the foremost authority on the gifts of the Spirit, especially in his day and time. And whenever he traveled with Howard Carter, who brought the gifts back into the church and started explaining how they worked, it was Howard Carter that started doing the teaching, but it was Dr. Summerall that took that teaching, functioned in these gifts, and then explained them and brought them into the church even more. And so I was very blessed to be able to sit under Dr. Summerall's teaching and to get an understanding of spiritual gifts and their operations, which some people may find rather amusing, because we have never really emphasized gifts. But it's because also another strong input in my life has been Dr. John Lake. And in that, his teaching has been more on the new creation and growing up into Christ in all things, Ephesians chapter 4 says. And if we are going to grow up into Him, then you have to realize that the gifts of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians 12 was written by the Apostle Paul to the church that he called carnal. And we have to realize that whenever we talk about these gifts, these are manifestations of the Spirit to meet any need or meet any problem that may arise in the life, really, of what I would call carnal Christians. And so, now, as a Christian matures, they will, and listen carefully, as I want to explain this very clearly. I'm not saying that as a Christian matures, that they need the Spirit less. I'm not saying that at all. What I'm saying is that as a Christian matures, they operate more in the fullness of the Spirit. In other words, they operate more by the Spirit and less by just explosions of power, which is what the gifts are. simply God manifesting himself in an explosion of power in different forms, and it's in a moment. I would say the gifts would be likened to events. When a gift is operated, it is an event. It is a point in time when this takes place. Whereas when a Christian matures, like Jesus, it no longer is a manifestation of the Spirit a gift, or no longer is it an event. Now it becomes a lifestyle. It just becomes who you are. And so it's never an event. Now it's just how you live. So, see, generally when people start, let's say, operating in words of knowledge or prophecy or things like that, usually what happens is it usually starts in church because that's where the gifts are either taught or practiced or whatever. And people start functioning them in church. And then they will start gradually branching out and touching lives in other places, hopefully. Many times they never do. But generally, it should branch out into an overflow, I would say, into other areas of your life. Now, eventually, what you want is for the Spirit to be manifesting 24/7 through your life, anywhere you go, all the time, so that it's no longer an event taking place. It is how you live. If someone calls you on the phone, you can actually talk to them, and as they need a problem, as they have mention a problem to you, you can meet that need by in the beginning, it'd be an event, a manifestation, a point in time where the Holy Spirit manifests himself. But as you start to function in these gifts on an ongoing basis, now it's no longer an event, and you can just start to flow. And somebody will say something, and you'll have an answer for them, and that will be by the Spirit of God. And it may be a word of knowledge, it may be a word of wisdom, and yet it is functioning, but it's not in a church setting. So, hope you understand what I mean by that. Now, Jesus functions all the time. Matter of fact, you see Jesus functioning more by the Spirit. Now, notice I didn't say in gifts of the Spirit, but you see him functioning more by the Spirit when he is out walking, walking through the streets, walking through the city, getting water at a well. You see him operating in the word of knowledge. All these things, not as much in the church or in the synagogue. You see him doing more of these things out around people, and just this is just who he was. He was allowing the Spirit to just flow through him, and there was not a now it's working and now it's not. It was just always on. That's Christian maturity. That's the way it's supposed to be. Now remember, Paul did write to the Corinthians, carnal church, and said, I don't want you to be ignorant. I want you to know how these things work. And then he starts explaining. So let's look on here. He says, verse 6, there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit. So now we know that these manifestations are the gifts, and the gifts are the manifestation of the Spirit. So every gift that happens is a manifestation of God himself working through a person. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man. Notice every man. If the Spirit of God operates in you, he can manifest through you. Now, the only thing that would hinder that would be if you have been taught that that doesn't exist anymore. And even then, it'll still function because God cares for people, but it won't be in a way that you'll recognize it. And so, again, we'll talk more of this when we talk about life in the Spirit. But he says here, but this manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. Now, when he says to every man to profit with all, he's saying, and he's talking here predominantly in the area of the church, in the area of a meeting of the church. And so we want to look at the point that the gift of the Spirit is for the benefit of everybody. It's for the benefit of anybody that has a problem, anybody that has a need. It's for the benefit of the body of Christ. It's not just for the benefit of the person ministering the gift. We have to realize that. God doesn't bless me with a gift because I'm spiritual enough or even faithful enough. We have to remember that whenever a gift is given, it's seldom for you. It's the gift manifests through you to someone else. So that is just a thing to remember about with the gifts. He says, verse 8, for to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom. Now notice, the word of wisdom. And Dr. Summerall, when he taught on these gifts, he was very clear to talk about that it was a word or the word. It was a specific word. In other words, it wasn't a general thing. It was when God specifically said, do this, say this, that there was a specific unction on these things. Now, as you mature, you get more sensitive to it, and you understand it more, and you I don't want to say you feel it, but you recognize it. That's the best way to say it. And he says, notice, for to one is given by the Spirit the word, and the word there is logos. It means literally, it's not rhema. Remember that. It is logos, and it means literally the thought of something, a general concept of something. And it's talking about a complete idea. And so there is given, for to one is given by the Spirit the word, the idea, the general concept of wisdom. And the word for wisdom there means technically an understanding, a knowing how to use knowledge, basically is the way most people say it. Then he says, to another, the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. Now I want to emphasize this where it says to another. When it says to another, it doesn't mean that, okay, you can only have this gift, and if you have that gift, you can only have one gift, but so you got that gift, and to another I'll give this gift, and to another I'll give this gift. That's not what he's referring to. The very word there, another, is a Greek word, and the Greek word is allos, and it means literally different or else. In other words, he's saying to this one, it'd be as if we said, okay, now I want that one to go over there, and I want you to go over there, and I want that one there to go over here, and to another person, I want another person over on this side. See, he's not specifying which other person, he is specifying different people. So he's saying, look, there are difference, these are different gifts. And so, but when it's the word allos actually means another one of the same nature or kind. So in other words, it's talking about a person, he is willing to manifest himself in different giftings through different people. Now, I will tell you, and let's look at this carefully, I want to be very clear on this. All of the gifts of the Spirit, as we call them, are manifestations of the Spirit. Manifestations of the Spirit of God. So, for instance, if I was here and I said, okay, I know that this person has a need and they need money for gas. Then I could say, oh, look, here's $20. Go get some gas. Now, or I could say, here's my gas card. You know, or here's a card. Go get some gas. Fill up your tank and bring me the card back. I could do that. And now notice, those are two different ways to accomplish the same goal. So that would be two different manifestations of me. You see, if I desired to meet that need, I could meet it through money, or I could say, come with me down and I'll go to the gas station with you and we'll fill up your car. So there's two different ways to meet the same need. This is key. Understand this. In the gifts, when he talks about this, he is saying that there are different ways. Now, if you needed healing, for example, you would, and you went to an A. Allen meeting, and let's say you had a pain or a bad back and couldn't bend over. Well, then, and be amazed, and bend over, and all the pain would be gone. See, these are all different manifestations of the same Spirit, the result being you got healed. But you wouldn't go to an A. Allen meeting and expect to get a word of knowledge, because usually Allen didn't work that way. So we have to realize the meeting you go to, you can't set the way you're going to get healed, or you can't set the way your need's going to get met. The person operating by the Spirit of God, that gift will operate through them, but it operates according to their personality, to their background, who they were around, how they function. The key is to go in and say, God, you're here. You're in that person, and I have this need, so I thank you for meeting my need. However you want to do it to that person, however it manifests, I don't care, just meet my need. See, that's the approach you want to take. Now, actually the highest approach would be for you to say, God, you're in me. Now, that's a whole other thing. But I want you to realize, the Spirit of God in Allen, the Spirit of God in Coe, the Spirit of God in Branham, it was the same Spirit, but they operated different ways, but got the same result. So the key is this. What lives in a Christian and makes a Christian is the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God lives in a person, and that makes him a Christian. Now, in the Spirit of God are all these gifts. Now, I'm not saying that there are gifts like right now in my pocket. I probably have a $1 bill, a $5 bill, a $10 bill, and a $20 bill. Okay, it's not like that's how gifts are. These are manifestations of the nature of God. These are manifestations of the character of God, of the Spirit of God. So God's nature and character is that he has wisdom. So he shares that. His nature and character is he has knowledge. He knows everything. So he can share a piece of that knowledge with a person right then that helps minister them. God's nature is health and healing. So he shares his nature and heals people. See, that's what this is all about. Each one of these manifestations of the Spirit are a manifestation of the nature and character of God. You want to know what God's like? There's several ways you can find out. One, look at Jesus. That's the number one way. That's how God has revealed himself to us in these last days. Number two, you can look at God and find out what he is like, what his nature is, by looking at the names that he has used throughout Scripture. And there are many of them. When I was being brought up in Christian circles, I was told that there was 16 names that he used, but actually there's many more than that. But he uses the name Jehovah Jireh, which means the Lord is our provider. So it shows that his nature is that of a father to provide. His another name he used was Jehovah Shalom, which means the Lord is our peace. So that shows his nature is peaceful. His nature is not chaotic. His nature is not confusion. His nature is peaceful. And the closer you get to God, and what I mean by that, the more you take his divine nature and it becomes part of you, the more peaceful you get. Now, I'm not saying you won't be active. I'm just saying even in the middle of action, you will have peace. Now, his name was Jehovah Shammah, which means the Lord is present, which shows his nature. He is always around you. He never leaves you nor forsakes you. He'll be with you to the end. See, all of these names show him. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord is your healer, is our healer, which means that it is his nature to heal. See, that's another way. Number one way to know God's nature is through Jesus. Look at Jesus. Another way is looking at the names that God himself has said, this is how I want to be known to you, and those names reveal his character. Now, another way to be known of God's nature, another way to know God's nature, is to look at 1 Corinthians 12, which has the gifts of the Spirit, and it shows by these gifts what he wants to share with us, and it shows his nature, because these are manifestations of himself. That's the key. These are manifestations of himself. God is wisdom. He is knowledge. He is all of these gifts of the Spirit. He is healing. He is revelation. All these things are aspects of his nature. So you can go through. Now, another aspect, the fourth way to know God, know his nature, is Galatians chapter 5, the fruit of the Spirit. God is love. He is peace. He is joy. He is long-suffering. I mean, come on. He is temperate. He is all of these things. So these are four ways. I would encourage anybody to take these four ways and study each one of them. And by getting an overall view, they will get a good picture of what God is like. And in none of these pictures will you ever see God as vindictive, as mean, waiting for a chance to bash you. Even the name for, you know, God is our judge. Even that is not in a sense of automatic judgment in a bad way. So he is a judge who's on our side. Now, let's look at the rest of these real quick. Moving on, he says, for to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, this is verse 8, to another the word of knowledge, and the word knowledge there means literally a specific knowledge, and it is the word gnosis, it means a knowing. So there will be a knowing. You say, okay, when did you learn that? I don't know, I just know it. I just all of a sudden knew it. I never learned it, I just knew it. Okay, if it's a specific instance, then that is a word of knowledge. Now, verse 9, to another, faith by the same Spirit. Faith. These are one of the gifts. Now, the gift of faith, and let me go ahead and read through some of it, and we'll come back to them, because I want to break these apart a little bit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, the gifts, plural, of healings, plural. Now, the word in the King James is just healing, it's singular. But if you look in the Greek, both words are plural. Gifts, plural, of healings, plural. Now, by the same Spirit. Verse 10, to another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues, or diverse kinds of tongues. And the word diverse there isn't even in the Greek, right? But it does mean that. To another, kinds of tongues. Means the same thing. To another, the interpretation of tongues. Now, that's not saying that if a person has tongues, they can't have the interpretation. You can remember, it's a spirit living in you, and in him is all of these manifestations of him. So, and this is my point in the beginning, is that if you have him, you have all these gifts. Now, this is one of the reasons why I firmly believe that when Paul told Timothy, he said, stir up the gift, singular, that is in you. And he said, I know it's in you because I put it in you, and I know it's in you by the laying on of my hands. Now, if you take those two things together, number one, the gift that's in you, and he tells you, told Timothy to stir it up, which, by the way, proves to us that we can stir up. We don't have to wait till it's stirred. We don't have to wait till we're moved upon. We can actually activate, which is what Wigglesworth said and John Lake said. Wigglesworth said that if the Spirit doesn't move me, I move the Spirit. He said, I may start in the flesh, but I will end up in the Spirit. John Lake said, it is a law of the human mind that I must act myself into believing faster than I can believe myself into acting. Now, those are some statements you need to get this CD, DVD, whatever it is you're going to get this by. Study this out, go through it, and take it apart and analyze it. Now, the key is here, though. With Timothy, Paul told Timothy, stir up the gift that is in you, that was in you by the putting on of my hands. Now, we don't see in the Bible, in the New Testament especially, any particular gift being given by the laying on of hands. I'm not saying it can't happen. I'm just saying we don't have examples of that in the New Testament. What we do have examples of in the New Testament is the gift of the Holy Ghost, which is what he said. If you repent, be baptized, then you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And we do see the apostles laying hands on people and they received the Holy Ghost. They even laid hands on them and said, receive the Holy Ghost. So the only gift, quote unquote, that we're told we can receive technically by Scripture, by the laying on of hands, is the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now the beauty of that is, once you receive the Holy Ghost, all those other gifts are in Him. So you could say, well, I received a gift of healing by laying on of hands. Not exactly, necessarily. You have the Holy Spirit in you, and in the Holy Spirit is the gifts of healings. Now you have to stir up that gift. So what he was telling Timothy was, stir up the Holy Spirit within you. Stir it up. Because you have to remember, Paul was writing to Timothy because they were telling him, you're too young, you don't know enough, you shouldn't be in charge, we're not listening to you, we're older than you. That's what Timothy was hearing. And Paul told Timothy, don't let any man despise your youth. Don't let anybody, don't listen to him. You do what I put you there to do. I put you in charge. You make sure everybody adheres to sound doctrine. You rebuke, you exhort, you do all of these things. You reprove, you do these things. You act in my stead just as I act in Jesus' stead. And he was telling him, you do that. And he said, I know what's in you. And he said, listen, Timothy, I want you to war a good warfare by the prophecies that have gone before on you. In other words, you have received prophecies, and that's how I want you to fight. And we'll talk about that a little bit later on, probably another session, because we're not going to have time, I don't think, today to get to that. Maybe the next session, maybe. But now, notice what you stir up is the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, as you stir up the gift of the Holy Ghost in you, then yeah, you can stir up particular gifts. Now, one of the best ways to stir up the gift of the Holy Ghost is praying in other tongues. And you say, well, I don't speak in other tongues. Okay, you should. You need to. It is a gifting of the Spirit. It is one of the things that is fundamental in the fullness of God working through you. You need to pray and speak in other tongues. As a matter of fact, we're going to correct all these things. We're going to be doing a one-day seminar on tongues and interpretation, diversities of tongues, how they operate, all the details on them. We're going to be going into detail on that. Now, look back at this. He says here, diverse kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the self-same Spirit. In other words, all these things, you notice how Paul kept coming back. He said, gift, but remember it's God. Gift, but remember it's God that it. Gift, but remember it's God that's doing it in you. And then at the end of it, he said, now all these gifts, remember, it's that same Spirit that's doing these things in you. So Paul kept saying, look, gifts are great. And you're going to see, he's going to tell you to covet gifts, and we're going to talk about that, a misconception that people have. But he said, these gifts, they're awesome, but remember, it's the Spirit of God that lives in you. It's the Spirit of God in you that allows these things. So never get too enamored with a gift to the point where you ignore the giver. and to the point where you forget who it is in you. The greatest gift we have ever received, and most people say, well, that's salvation. Yeah, but how do you get saved? You can't get saved without the Spirit of God moving into you. The very purpose, Galatians predominantly, but if you read that, he goes through and proves that the very reason that Jesus came and then left was so that we could receive the Spirit of God. So that once again, the Spirit of God could dwell in man and not just be upon him like a cloak or a coat. That God actually mingles with man, joins with man, changes his nature. That is the greatest gift. The gift, don't forget the fact that it is the true and living and holy God who is living in us. And that's why many times the Spirit, it says, lusteth to envy against. But why? Because we give attention to other things. And he's saying, hey, what about me? Hey, what about God? What about the things of God? What about holiness? What about righteousness? And yet your mind is somewhere else. And it is the Holy Spirit in you lusting to envy, saying, man, I wish I had their mind. I wish I had their thoughts. I wish I could be more in communion with them. That's what he is referring to. That the fact that we have the Spirit of God, the living God in us, there is nothing greater than that. And it is so amazing when you stop and think that the very God of the universe, the ultimate top being in existence, has agreed to dwell in each one of us. There is nothing above that, nothing beyond that. There is nothing greater than that. Just the fact that we are together in oneness and in union together. So, sorry, I'll get off and start preaching on that and take me right into the new man. So, here he says, now look at verse 11. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. Now, when he says severally, he says basically what that means is himself. It doesn't mean he chops it up and gives, okay, there's two for you and there's three for you and I'm giving you several of each. He doesn't even mean that. He's saying to sever, to cut apart. And he's saying he gives to every man these giftings by the work of the Holy Spirit and that they work themselves out through the life of this person. And he does it. And a lot of people say, well, see, it's by God's will. Okay, it's not saying as he will in the sense of as he chooses. What it's saying is, as he will, meaning he chooses, he decides, he has decided to do this with every believer, he has decided to do this. So it's not that he's going to do it at some point, he goes, okay, let me see you, okay, here's a gift, oh, no, I got another gift waiting for you later. No, he has decided, I'm giving myself to you. Remember, these gifts are manifestations of him. This is not like handing you something, these are not that kind of gift. These are manifestations of him. So he doesn't cut himself off and give you a piece of himself. In other words, what he's saying is, I will manifest through myself through you in all kinds of ways, pretty much in any way you will let me, because it's my desire. So now, when it says he will, matter of fact, I want to go back to that. There, it means to be willing. It means he is willing, and even the tense there means he is always willing, just as we said before in other scriptures, other studies that we've done. Now, look at this verse 12. For as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. Notice the Spirit is what joins you to the body, it's what puts you in the body. Whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. So again, he's emphasizing the oneness of the church, the oneness of the body of Christ. He's talking, what makes us one? It is the fact that we all share the same Spirit. We all share the same Spirit. And when I say share, I don't mean you get a piece and I get a piece. I'm saying he is 100% inside of me. And he is 100% inside of you, if you're a believer. I'm telling you, he is inside of you completely. And because he is God, he can be 100% where you are and 100% where I am. Now, the key is us letting him manifest himself 100%. That's where most have fallen short over the centuries. Now, he says, verse 14, for the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I'm not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? Now notice, he's saying, if a person says, well, I'm not like that. I'm not a speaker like so-and-so. I can't talk like this person can. So I just don't count. What, do you realize what he's saying there? He's saying the fact that you say you don't count doesn't mean you don't count. He's saying, can he say that he's not of the body? Does that make him not of the body? He's saying what he's saying has nothing to do with the reality. The reality is you do count. The reality is you are just as much a part of the body of Christ as the greatest speaker, the greatest healer, the greatest anything. Why? Because it's the Spirit in you that makes you part of the body. And you have in you the same Spirit that is in the best speaker, best healer, best whatever you are out there. So, he goes on. He says, where are we at? Yep. In verse 16, and if the ear shall say, because I'm not the eye, I'm not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the healing? Or the hearing, sorry. Healing on my mind there. Where would be the hearing? If the whole body were hearing, where would be the smelling? And what he's saying, look, just because you may not be that part doesn't mean you're not important. Your part is important. He says, but now hath God, verse 18, but now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it hath pleased him. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? In other words, we need every part of the body. But now are they many members, yet but one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more, now listen to this, much more those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. In other words, the easiest thing to hurt on your body is your eye. It's really easy. A speck of dust gets in your eye and all of a sudden everything stops. I mean, the whole body is all of a sudden concerned with a speck of dust in your eye. And you can be holding a baby and they'll stick their finger in your eye and they don't mean anything by it, but all of a sudden, you ever notice both eyes start watering? And all of a sudden now everything stops. Everything takes the attention to the hurt part. Why? Because the eyes, it's an important part of the body, but it's also the weakest. It's amazing how God made that. Now, watch this. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor. And our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. Now, for instance, some people like feet. Right? And they look at people's feet and they have pretty feet and pretty feet and this kind of stuff. I've personally never really understood that thing. But I do know this. You, especially during the first century, the way they got around was predominantly walking in sandals in dirt. Their feet were dirty. They were scratched up, beat up, probably didn't look very good, and probably in pretty rough shape. And even the ones that had sandals, a lot of them were even barefooted. And so their feet would have to be very tough, very callous, very, I would even say beat up, okay? Just because of their life. But the Bible is very clear and says, how beautiful are the feet of those that bring the gospel. Think about that. How beautiful. Now, they're not saying, look at those feet. Oh, they're perfectly clean. They're manicured. They're oiled. The skin is soft. There's no callus on the foot or anything like that. It's not saying that at all. It's saying what that foot does, what that dirty, beat-up foot does is it brings the gospel, and that's what makes it beautiful. It's not how it looks. It's what it functions. It's what it does that makes it beautiful. It's the fact that it carries the gospel. That's what God is trying to say here through Paul. Is he's trying to say, look, just because something doesn't look that good doesn't mean it's not very important. The eye, the mouth, especially during that day, a preacher couldn't do much if he didn't have feet to get around. It didn't matter how eloquent he was, didn't matter how good of a speaker or anything else he was, if his feet couldn't get him to where he needed to be to preach to people, his mouth wasn't of much help. And so we have to realize the body works together. Now this is, again, I don't hate to harp on this. I do it all the time and I need to do it. This is why life teams are so vital. Life teams are vital because they take every person and every person gets to function in a role that God has put in them, in the church, in the local body there, and they get to function in a way that they would not get to function any other way. So life teams are vital. Now watch, he goes on here. I'm going to have to shut down in just a minute, and we'll pick this back up in the next session. But he says, less honorable coming up to verse 24. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked, that there should be no schism in the body, no dividing, no breaking apart, but that the members should have the same care one for another. You ought to treat everybody the same, no matter what their giftings are. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now these are key elements of body life coming together as a group, as the body of Christ. Verse 27, now you are the body. Look, God put verse 28 in here on purpose. So let's read it. And God hath set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. You notice how he lists all these things in here. Then he says, are all apostles? Well, of course the answer is no. Are all prophets? Of course, now let me ask you, can anybody be saved? Can anybody be saved? Well, of course the answer is yes. Anybody can be saved. Would God reject any person that comes to him, repentant, turning to him, coming to him for salvation, meeting the conditions, we would say? Would God reject any person that comes to him for salvation? Well, of course, if you know the Bible, you know the answer is no. So any person can be saved. I hope you're shaking your head yes and saying, yes, Curry, let's move on. Okay? Any person can be saved. Now let me ask you this. Are all saved? Well, hopefully you'll answer the correct answer according to the Bible too. No, they're not. Now, Jesus paid the price, so anybody could be. But everybody is not. Now the fact is, anybody could, but everybody's not. So, now watch. Let's read this with that in mind. Are all apostles? No. Are all prophets? No. Are all teachers? No. Are all workers of miracles? No. Have all the gifts of healing? No. Do all speak with tongues? No. Do all interpret? No. Now, we answered no to every one of those. But, just because we answered no, and notice, we could go right back to, are all apostles? No. But could all be? Yes. Are all prophets? No. But could all be prophets? Yes. But then if we were all prophets or all apostles, then where would the hearing be? See, apostles see and prophets hear. Now, I'm using general terms. But you have to realize that we need all of them. We need apostles. We need prophets. We need miracles. We need teachers. We need all this. But just because it's saying, are all any one of these? No. But or could all be any one of these? Yes. Why? Because Jesus, the chief apostle, the prophet, right? The miracle worker, the healer, the one that knows all things, he lives in each believer. So any believer can be any of those things, theoretically and potentially. Now, do they function that? No. And I really believe that a lot of what you function in determines, in other words, your personality, your preferences, those things determine where you go, what you study, who you're around, and those will determine what you will eventually be. Now, I do know that God knows what you'll be. But remember, God's foreknowledge is not his foreordaining or his foreordination. And that's like prophecy. Just because God knows what's going to happen doesn't mean that he wants it to happen. And just because he said this is going to happen doesn't mean he wants it to happen. It just means he knows it's going to happen. So just because he knows something doesn't mean that he automatically agrees with it. Right? So we can, again, get into that later. He says in verse 30, have all the gifts of healing, do all speak with tongues. Now, let's talk about this. Do all speak with tongues? Well, we say no, but can all? Yes. Should all? Yes. Do all interpret? No. Should all? Yes. Can all? Yes. Now, the reason we say that is because we also have to differentiate. When it talks about tongues and speaking in tongues, predominantly in Corinthians, you have to remember, Corinthians was written about body life. It's talking about when believers, should they all prophesy? Can they? Yeah, because he says you may all prophesy one by one. But, and I want to give this example because I've had it happen in meetings before. We do training and activation, and we will have all the believers stand up and speak in other tongues. And they will pray in their, as we would call it, prayer language or speak in other tongues, and they will use it to build up in their inner man, strengthen their inner man. It talks about in Ephesians chapter 3. It says they build up the inner man. And so it says that you are to build yourself up praying in the Holy Ghost. Build yourself up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost in Jude. So as you pray in tongues, praying in the Holy Ghost, you build yourself up. You edify yourself. Now, because of that, that is tongues. And if I can pray in tongues right now, I can do it anywhere, anytime I choose to. And then so when we come together in a meeting and I say, okay, everybody get up, and everybody began praying in tongues. They can all pray in tongues. Well, I've had people in meetings say, well, this isn't scriptural because the Bible says not for everybody to speak in tongues at the same time. Diversities of tongues. There are differences of how tongues operate. Now, in giving a message in tongues in the church, yeah, everybody should be doing it at the same time. There ought to be one person gets a message in tongues, they give that message, and then another person, possibly, gives the interpretation. But that is a message for the body. That is not you building yourself up. When I have everybody stand up and pray in tongues, it is not so we can get a message from God for the body. It is for you to build yourself up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, praying in tongues. And you can do that anytime, anywhere. And if I can do it individually anywhere, why can't we all do it together at one time, as long as we're not trying to make every person praying in tongues a message for the body? See, this is where people, they get messed up, because they think that this is all referring to the same thing, and it's not. When the 120 spoke in other tongues, they all began glorifying God, they all did it at the same time, and they didn't do it one by one. They all did it at the same time, right? So that was by the reception of the Holy Spirit, and it's all through the book of Acts, and so that's a whole different thing. That is not tongues being brought forth as a message to be interpreted in the church. Right, so we should get that clear. That's a big deal. It's a big stumbling block for a lot of people in the church. Now, I'm going to have to break off here. I'll read this last sentence, and we'll come back and pick this back up. In verse 31, it says, "But covet earnestly the best gifts." Now, I'm reading out of King James. And he says, "But covet earnestly the best gifts." Now, let's clear this up very quickly. He says here to covet. That means to earnestly desire, to crave. Earnestly. Even the word earnestly there is where we get our word zealous. So to crave, to earnestly desire, to covet. And it says the best gifts. Now, that's not the best way to interpret, to translate that. The word best there doesn't mean the best gift. And in terms of this is the best gift as opposed to that best gift. As we've always said before, the best gift is the gift a person needs at the time. Now, it can be different ways. You know, but the idea best here does not mean best. The Greek word for best here is a Greek word mezon, and it means literally to a greater degree. What it means, all he's saying is, listen, covet earnestly, strongly the gifts more than you ever have, and covet them so that they will be manifested to a greater degree. You covet the gifts so that the gift can function more fully. In other words, instead of having a word of knowledge and we say, there is a person in this room that has a headache. Okay, that would be a very weak, a very limited display of a manifestation of the Spirit. Is it true? Yeah. But now, a person who would desire that same word of knowledge to a greater degree, they would, to the gift in a greater degree, would be this. That gift operated best would be to be able to say, excuse me, sir, right back there, you've been having a migraine headache for the last 3 weeks, and you see the difference? I'm saying the same thing. I'm saying there's somebody in this room that has a headache. But that gift of knowing someone is there that has a headache to a best degree or to a greater degree would be able to point that person out and say, you, it's a migraine, it's been 3 weeks. You see the difference? That would be the same gift, but the second way of using that gift would be best. You get that? Hope you understand what that means. There is no best gift. So that's I really had to straighten that up, because there is a lot of confusion over that. So, and what people do is they try to think of a best gift, and they go after that, and they ignore the other. We're going to break, and then we will come back in a few minutes and pick this up. in the second session. So I hope this has helped you. God bless you. Stay with us. Bless you. Be healed. If you can, I'll just say be healed right now. If you want to understand these gifts, begin to function in them more, crave them, covet them, ask God to reveal them and manifest Himself through you even more so. If you do not pray in other tongues, you have not received the Holy Ghost, pray, ask Him right now. It is a gift for God's children. So, God bless you, receive the Holy Ghost, be healed, be blessed, in Jesus' name. Amen.